what do you think should be done to, I guess, really educate the public in terms of the scare tactics that are being used to, in effect, take over the entire economy?
Well, you know, I think the truth
you have about 5 seconds.
Well, the truth is going to set us free, and the internet, I think, is leading the way with open communication for every single person, not only in the United States, but around the world.
Watch the show. Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program, we have John Cameron, the owner of CustomSalesTraining.com and the Effective Leadership Coach.com, and I'm sure probably other ventures.
Yes.
Other ventures by now. Welcome to the show, John. Also, Ed Gonzalez, who is both a high school principal, I'm sorry, a grade school principal.
Grade school.
As well as the Libertarian Party candidate against Zoe Lofgren in the 16th Congressional District in the Bay Area.
That is correct.
Ed, why are you running against Zoe Lofgren for Congress? Why do you want to go to that nasty place?
I'm running against Zoe Lofgren because I think she has been an absolute disaster when it comes to almost every single economic issue that we face. You look at the economy in the United States right now, we're in the greatest economic downturn since the Great Depression. Total unemployment in the United States is almost 16%, and California probably approaching over 20%. And her voting record has led us there for over 15 years. She's a disaster on economics, and it's time for her to go.
What are your chances of getting the attention of the voters in your district?
In any other year, almost nothing. But 2010 is not a normal year. People are very upset. They're looking at the Wall Street bailouts. They're looking at the bailouts of the auto industry, big government spending programs, taxes going up. They're angry, they're frustrated, they know that government's not the answer. So this year, I stand a real chance of defeating
him. You're running in a three-way contest.
That is correct.
I assume it's three-way with the Republican opponent as well. Is the Republican candidate putting on a credible race?
Well, he's out there. As far as I can tell, he has not yet raised the $5,000 to report to the FEC. So I think I could consider that if he's raised less than $5,000, he's not going to be getting out there as much as I will be getting out there with radio ads, with posters and signs up all over the district, and going out to different community groups every single week talking to the voters.
Tell me the geographic confines of the district.
The geographic confines as far as Democrat-Republican?
No.
Geographic.
Okay.
So it's taking up almost all of San Jose and Santa Clara County. It reaches all the way out to the foothills and then goes all the way down to not only Morgan Hill, but San Martin, which is just south of Morgan Hill. It reaches almost all the way into Gilroy.
Is the voter registration, does it lean Democrat or Republican?
It leans very, very Democrat. But the thing is that it's Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley is full of entrepreneurs. So that while they're registered to get Democrats, we have a group of fiscally conservative voters, regardless of whether they're registered Democrat, Independent, Republican, or Libertarian.
I would guess that you would have a good chance of getting the people who consider themselves to be fiscally conservative and socially liberal in a district like that.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that speaks directly to what the majority of voters are in Silicon Valley. They are fiscal conservatives, but liberal on most social issues.
Tell me what your life background, what do you bring to the table? Why is it, other than the fact that you're a libertarian, that people should vote for you?
Well, first, I think that I represent the voters of Silicon Valley better than Zoe Lofgren. I am a strong fiscal conservative, and I lean liberal on most social issues. I'm an elementary school principal, a private school principal. We focus very much on academics and teaching the children to be individuals and to strive to achieve academic and personal excellence, and we take standardized tests just like everyone else, and the average student in our school is in the top 5% for the nation. So I bring a key understanding of education to the table. On top of that, I served for 5 years in the United States Marine Corps. I deployed twice in support of Operation Iraqi Freedom. The second time I went to Iraq, I was an advisor and trainer to the Iraqi forces. My job was to go into fairly dangerous villages in the Al Anbar province, create a stable and secure environment and also rebuild their economy. Our team did this on multiple occasions. We provided security and stability. We helped revitalize the economy, and we were able to pull out and leave no American forces there. And we were able to transition that area over to the Iraqis. So I bring an understanding of real-world economics as well as an understanding of education that I think Zoe Lofgren lacks in both cases.
Where did you get your understanding of real-world economics? What economic theory do you consider to be real-world economics?
I would consider myself to be an Austrian economist. The specific reason for that is my experiences in Iraq, moving into small farming and fishing villages that were dealing with the atrocities of war, having the real wealth of those villages really destroyed, seeing an economy that was not thriving, that was not working. But when you move in and you establish safety, security, and you protect property rights, all of a sudden the economy will start to thrive again. In these particular cases, fishermen that were not fishing at a surplus, that were just surviving. Once security was established, they started fishing again and fishing at a surplus. The farmers started working their crops and their lands again and bringing out crops at a surplus. Once security was established, they were then able to open up the marketplace and take these surplus goods to the market.
Was this in the Lake District of Iraq? You said fishing, the reason I asked.
This was along the Euphrates River.
Okay.
I could see the Haditha Dam from where I was.
Mm-hmm.
So I could see the Haditha Dam right up there.
So the fishing was from the river?
Yes, from the Euphrates.
A question, have you had any other experience with economic upheaval in your life that would have also led you to that? Anything from any other parts of your life?
Yes, I have a strong bias against what the Federal Reserve is doing right now because in 2001, I experienced a hyperinflation or massive inflation, however you want to define it, in Buenos Aires, Argentina. I arrived in August of 2001, and when I left in December, as a result of the deficit spending and money printing of the Argentine government, I watched the Argentine peso experience a massive devaluation. I watched prices quadruple in a period of less than 3 weeks. Families begging for food in the streets, and large crowds of people storming grocery stores to get at the food they could no longer afford was all part of my experience. Now people say, that's Argentina, it's a South American country, could never happen here in the United States. But since this economic crisis began in September of 2008, the Federal Reserve has created, out of thin air, over a trillion dollars, and given it to incompetent, corrupt bankers so they could pay themselves bonuses. The economic fate and the inflation of Argentina is exactly what we're going to get here in the United States if we continue down this path. We cannot print money as a way to get us out of these problems.
Can't print more money. We're already printing money.
Well, we're already printing money.
Would that be a good time to ask you about your feelings about taxation at the federal level, excise, flat tax, national sales tax? What's your vision of a fair and equitable tax?
Well, to me, any tax system that we have has to be simple, it has to be easy, and every single person with a high school education should be able to understand it. That does not describe the current tax system that we have right now. It's incredibly complicated. There's massive loopholes, and if you send your taxes to 40 different tax professionals, you're going to get 40 different reports back to you. It's written that way specifically so people with political connections and politicians can use those loopholes to play favorites. I think the whole system is corrupt. We should throw out the entire tax system and replace it with something simple and easy. I lean towards a flat national sales tax. Certainly not perfect. No tax
kind of
system
like a VAT,
is.
Or?
No, I am absolutely against a VAT, which is essentially increases, puts tax on something starting from when you dig it out of a ground. Mm-hmm. So if you were going to have a VAT, which I'm against, when a farmer starts to bring crops up, that's going to be taxed right there. When mm-hmm. he sells it to a wholesaler, there's going to be another tax mm-hmm. put on it. When he brings it to the grocery store, there'll be another tax mm-hmm. put on it. And when it finally goes to the consumer, there'll be another tax. What I'm talking about, a flat national sales tax, sometimes known as a fair tax, mm-hmm. means one single tax at the point of at the retail level.
So it's sold from wholesale to retail, no tax there, only
no tax.
At the point of, okay.
How would you finesse the problem that if a fair tax or a flat sales tax was enacted, you would still have the possibility of bringing back an income tax and thus ending up with both the sales tax and the income tax?
Well, I mean, that's the thing. We would have to throw out the current system and replace it with something. I'm not in favor of adding in any additional taxes. I think we need to have one simple, easy-to-understand system that everyone can understand.
You talked about politicians playing favorites. There's another huge group that has a vested interest in the tax code. It's CPAs, tax preparers, tax lawyers, all the people who work collecting tax at all the various agencies and all the rest of that. They're a very, very powerful lobby, maybe even more powerful than the politicians handing out favors. What are you going to do? What's going to happen there?
Well, you know, as one person, as one future congressman, there's not much that I can do. But there's a movement going on in the United States right now, this Tea Party movement, mm-hmm. this fiscal conservative small government movement. Voters are fed up with special favors. They're fed up with politicians playing favorites. They're fed up with special interest groups. And a strong group of fiscally conservative congressmen can go in and make this happen. That's mm-hmm. what it's going to take. It's going to take a national movement to make that change, and I think we're starting to see that now.
Excellent. Now, what about, you're a former Marine.
I'm a former Marine.
Never an ex-Marine, former Marine.
That is correct. I'm actually still a captain in the United States Marine Reserve.
Okay. So, what's your view of U.S., let's call it defense policy?
We need to, the U.S. government absolutely needs to have national defense as a priority. That includes defending our territory, defending our borders. So I'm not really sure why we have over 700 foreign military bases outside the United States. I understand the need to project power at times, especially in this age of long-range missiles. Mm-hmm. I understand having logistical bases overseas, but if we closed 75% of our foreign bases overseas, that would still leave us with over 175 bases. I bet you that we could provide strong national security with less than 100 foreign bases, and that's what I advocate. Let's start with shutting down 75% of the foreign bases.
What bases would you close down? More specifically, what bases would you keep open? What countries would you retain bases in?
Well, I think you need to look at the area and you need to consolidate. I mean, look at Europe. We are currently subsidizing the military defense of Europe. Why? Who are we protecting them from? We
should. Would you keep any military troops, any NATO troops, any military troops in Germany or the rest of the NATO countries at all?
I'm sure we could have one base there to help with one or a couple bases there to help with logistics. But again, I don't see the need for over 700 worldwide.
Would you keep bases in the Middle East? We have a huge bases now, obviously, in Iraq and Afghanistan. Would you keep them there?
I think it's time to close all of the bases in Iraq and Afghanistan.
You've been there. You've been on the ground. You think that the security of Iraq would be just fine without the U.S. presence?
Well, I think that's eventually where we need to go, and I think that is where we're heading. We need to start, you know... It was announced just yesterday that the combat operation in Iraq is over, but we still have 50,000 troops in Iraq. And if you look at Japan, which I currently have a little brother stationed there now, if you look at South Korea, we still have fighting men and women over there, even though these wars have been over for decades and decades.
Would you close the military operations in, say, South Korea, where North Korea still does pose something, what some people would consider to be a viable threat?
I would advocate closing the bases in Japan immediately. South Korea, I think that their GDP and economic base would allow them to take care of North Korea. I recognize that they are still a potential threat. So again, we would still need to keep some bases open, but the 700 that we currently have is absolutely unsustainable.
Okay, so you close down three-quarters of the bases overseas with a concomitant reduction, I presume, in defense spending. Would you continue to spend money on anti-missile defense, on Star Wars-type programs?
No. I think it's time to start cutting those programs.
You think that the former Soviet Union would and other nuclear powers would not prevent a long-term threat against with nuclear weapons and missiles and so forth?
Well, there's obviously, you know, we live in a we do live in obviously a dangerous world, and we need to have a strong military that can protect us. What I'm advocating is taking a look at the bloated military spending. A lot of these technological programs, these dreams of politicians to build, the military-industrial complex, really, to build these incredibly technologically advanced things which cost us literally trillions of dollars over the years. We need to start paring back a lot of these programs.
One of the allegations or assertions that Milton Friedman made, that the actual level of taxation is spending level. Whatever your spending level is, that is, in fact, your taxation level, because it's going to be paid for either through inflation or through tax revenues themselves. And you're talking about cutting back on the Defense Department spending. Where else would you cut back on spending, and to what degree?
Well, I think we need to balance the budget, period.
That's fine. Where would you cut the spending to balance the budget?
Well, look at the Department of Education right now. The Department of Education currently sucks money out of communities, sucks money away from individuals. It swirls it around Washington, D.C., and gives back to communities less than they took, along with a huge stack of regulations like this current one, No Child Left Behind, which has been an absolute disaster. The Department of Education does not educate children. It does not help our education system. I think it can be eliminated completely. So there's one thing right there. Medical expenses with Medicare and Medicaid, that is something that also needs to get under control immediately. We're going to have to start cutting back on the free entitlement programs when it comes to health care. That is not something that is sustainable over the next decade or two.
You would vote for, then, the repeal of Obamacare?
Yes, I would vote for the repeal of Obamacare immediately. I would move to expand health savings accounts to all individuals, and I would also move to allow insurance companies to compete across state lines, which they currently cannot.
Why do you think that is, that they can't compete across state lines?
I'm sure there's lots of reasons with special interest groups. That essentially, insurance companies have their own little monopolies within certain states. It allows them to overcharge for services. If all of a sudden insurance companies can compete across state lines, you're going to have much higher levels of competition. You're going to have increased service and lowering of costs.
Can I ask you a question about competition? And I don't hear this mentioned much, but we talk about every place where there is what we used to call cutthroat competition, such as in Silicon Valley, which is where you're working and living and hopefully representing us here soon.
Yeah.
Because there is very little regulation of technology, there have been tremendous advancements in technology, and the actual computing power per dollar has increased phenomenally over the years. And then where we see costs grow exorbitantly is wherever we have lack of competition, such as in the healthcare field. You have monopoly through the AMA. You have a self-protecting association, American Medical Association, which limits the numbers of doctors that can come in the field and treat, and then puts an exorbitant barrier in the way of anyone to enter the market.
Correct.
Do you favor allowing people to freely compete in the healthcare world?
Absolutely. I favor free market competition in every industry, to include healthcare. One of the things that Congress really needs to go after is the FDA. The FDA has huge amounts of regulations when it comes to bringing new drugs to market. It takes many cases over a decade to bring new drugs to market, and tens of millions, if not close to $100 million, to bring a single new drug to market. It's a completely inefficient system. It reduces the amount, it reduces consumer choice. It pushes costs up dramatically. If Congress can start to attack institutions like the FDA, start to increase competition when it comes to actually testing the actual new medications and drugs, you're going to see better results.
The Supreme Court case Pearson versus Shalala and other cases have established the ability of the herbal medicine field, the supplement field,
yes,
to make truthful claims about their products without FDA harassment.
Mm-hmm.
You support that?
I absolutely do. You know, the government should certainly be concerned with force and fraud. If a company has a product, it's being honest about what it puts in the product, it's being honest about what the product does and potential side effects, then they should be allowed to sell it, period.
Would you support a dismantling of the postal monopoly?
I think that if a dismantling of the postal monopoly, yes. All we have to do, we just need to allow the competition to exist, and if we allow the competition to exist, just like in Silicon Valley with technology, amazing things will happen. The free market works.
Would you consider yourself to be a part of the Ron Paul group of congressmen, should you be elected?
Yes, I am a libertarian through and through.
Would you support the Ron Paul program to first audit the Fed, second eliminate the Fed, and another bill that he's put on, which would make it possible for basically repeal the legal tender laws, make it possible for other commodities or other forms of money to compete side by side with
Yes.
Federal Reserve notes?
I advocate not only auditing the Federal Reserve completely, but also allowing individuals to trade in the precious metals without taxation, period. So take away all sales and capital gains tax from gold and silver. Allow people to hold their savings in those precious metals, which would essentially create a competition in currency.
Hmm. What other activities that the Federal Reserve now does would you privatize?
Well, I think that they artificially pushing interest rates down to incredibly low levels when they shouldn't be there is horrible for our economy. Look at the housing crisis. People went out and bought large houses that they could not afford with artificially low interest rates, with money essentially pumped into the system by the Federal Reserve. They gave us the money that created this huge housing bubble and the huge bust that has brought our economy to its knees. We need to, the Federal Reserve needs to stop tinkering with the interest rates, period.
Are you concerned with privacy issues? There's a school in the Chicago area, Palos Heights School District number 128, which is tagging kids' backpacks with GPS tracking devices. There's also the recent disclosure that police are putting GPS devices on cars
mm-hmm.
in parked in people's driveways without getting a search warrant beforehand.
Okay.
Do these kinds of invasions of privacy concern you?
Certainly any invasion of privacy concerns me. When it comes to GPS on backpacks in Chicago, this really comes back to the idea of decentralization and local control in government. I can't answer that question because I'm not a parent in that school. Do the parents know that what's going on with their children and their backpacks? Have they agreed to it? Why is the school doing it? Are there dangers that we don't know about? These are questions that I cannot answer because I'm not a parent in that school.
Well, the rationale is to make it impossible for kids to get lost.
Right.
And with the acquiescence of the parents, I'm sure.
The thing is that...
Does it present a precedent, or does it present an intrusion of technology into a place where perhaps it should not be?
Again...
Tracking people wherever they go.
I would not allow my son, who's a kindergartner, to have his backpack tagged by police or teachers or the school with a GPS device. But again, I favor decentralization of control when it comes to government. You need to have local governments and individuals making decisions for themselves that make sense. That's not something that the federal government should be involved in at all.
So then you would make it strictly a voluntary thing at the local level?
Correct. If a parent really wants to put a GPS device on their child, then that's up to the parent. It's not something that I'm going to do, but I'm not going to tell a parent how to raise their child. It's not something for politicians to answer.
In this case, it's this particular one is an RFID chip
mm-hmm.
Where the kids are basically scanned on the bus.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea, I guess, is they don't want kids left on the bus or getting off the wrong exit or anything like that. And the technology is pretty inexpensive. It's like $16,000. I don't know how much, if that's a subsidized cost or not. But it just occurs to me that every time I read about these kinds of things happening. It's where parents have kind of abdicated responsibility over training their children, being responsible for their children, watching their children, putting checklists in place, a simple process of, okay, you get off the bus by the big tree. Even if you're 4 years old and don't know your colors yet or your numbers or anything else, you can recognize the big tree. So I just look at this, and every time I see a case like this, it's government taking over for the parent, and that's what scares me.
Well, I do. I'm absolutely against government taking over the role of parent when it comes to children. And in this particular case, I'm not familiar with what was it government doing it. Was this a school board
school
program?
School district. But the
parents,
one particular school.
Right. The parents wanted. Was this voluntarily by the parents? If a parent's going to put a GPS tracker on their child, it's not something that I'm going to do. But as a congressman, it is not for me to tell a parent how to raise their child.
You do that with an iPhone app.
on the campaign. How's polling going? Are you polling in the race? Do you know?
We have not done any polling in District 16.
Do you plan on doing any polling?
We plan to do on polling come September. Well, we're in September now, so towards the end of September, we're going to be doing some polling.
Are you hiring outside folks to do a statistically valid poll? Or are you doing it internally?
We're going to do it internally.
Okay.
What is the fundraising status? Are you raising enough money that you have to file all kinds of onerous campaign finance reports?
I do. I've been filing FEC reports now for almost a year, so I certainly have more money than my Republican than the Republican candidate. Not as much as Zoe Lofgren, but I have. But
never
I have.
Never mind. Almost said a bad word there.
But I have raised enough money, so we're going to do some serious radio ads. We're going to be having posters up all over the area. So we've got a small little war chest that we're going to make. We're going to make the most of it.
And has Zoe Lofgren agreed to debate you?
She has not agreed to debate me, but
you of course challenged her.
I have of course challenged her, but I want to make sure that we're going to make a lot of noise and hopefully get a lot of attention coming our way.
Would you like to give us your website? How can people get in touch with you if they'd like to support your campaign?
All you have to do is search Edward Gonzalez for Congress. The actual website is edwardmgonzalez.com. But search Edward Gonzalez for Congress. It'll pop right up. Again, we've got a nice little war chest, but if we're going to keep these radio ads going, we're going to want more money. So please, if you can, make a donation. Anything can help. Again, Edward Gonzalez for Congress.
And if you'd like to have your friends and neighbors watch this program when it re-airs on Friday at noon or Saturday morning at 4 a.m., you can do so at www.accesssacramento.org. That's the show. We'll see you again next week, same time, same place on the Libertarian Counterpoint.